Okay, now I have to go back and start now today's lecture on, as I said, two young sociologists, Çağlar Keyder and Nilüfer Göle. Now Çağlar Keyder is younger than me, a year younger than me, and Nilüfer Göle is 7-8 years younger than me. As a matter of fact, she was a student of mine in Middle East Technical University when she was an undergraduate student. Anyway, first, let me start with Çağlar Keyder and then go to Nilüfer Göle. But I put them together because and these two sociologists share, on the one hand, share a common framework. That common framework is perhaps sociological, a sociology which is a synthesis of Marx, Weber, Durkheim. Parsons sometimes is included in their works, and of course French sociologists, especially in Nilüfer Göle's case, her PhD professor is a French sociologist, Alain Train, and she gives references to Bourdieu. So they share some approach and paradigmatic similarity. There is a paradigmatic similarity in their theoretical approaches, but their research diverged, I would say. Maybe I can make a parallel with one of our previous sessions, lectures on Mübeccel Kray and Şerif Mardin. Now, if you remember there, Mübeccel Kray was more structuralist, structure-oriented, functionalist, structuralist, Marxist organization of labor, etc. Whereas Şerif Mardin was more Weberian, culturalist, sociology of religion, sociology of knowledge, and in terms of the development of sociology in Turkey, they their emphases were parallel to other research, that is more those sociologists who are more emphasizing cultural aspects, identity aspects, whereas others, survival, structural transformation, development, industrialization. In these two, Çağlar Keyder is more focusing on structural aspects, world systems, emphasis, or transformation of Turkish, Ottoman Turkish socioeconomic structures on within the framework of world capitalist system. Okay, let me put it that way. Of course, he also makes some references to ideological, cultural, identity aspects, but his focus is more on political economy, socioeconomic, structural aspects. Now, Nilüfer Göle focused on cultural aspects and identity aspects, and women's studies, studies on religion, studies on Islamic women and their identity problems. Of course, she also makes some references to class and other socioeconomic aspects, but her main focus is cultural identitarian aspects of Turkish modernization, or as she calls it, Turkish alternative modernization. Okay, now after this introduction, now let me go in detail, or in summary actually, of Çağlar Kaydar's work. But before I go into his work, let me note that his BA is in economics actually. So he was he started not as a sociologist, but as economist, and his degree is from Yale University in 1969. And then he obtained his PhD also in economics, and this time from University of Berkeley in 1997. But his work is sociology, in sociological analysis of modernization of Ottoman Turkish society and state. Although, for example, when he's working in Middle East Technical University, I was in Department of Sociology, he was in Department of Economics in Middle East Technical University too, but in his later work, later life, work life, in Boğaziçi University, he was in the Department of Sociology, and as a matter of in the Institute of Atatürk Institution, that is Republican reforms and Republican transformations. He was appointed in both in the center and also in the department, and he was jointly teaching in Binghamton State University of New York's branch in Binghamton. State University of New York has several campuses, and he was teaching. He's still, I think, teaching in Binghamton Sociology Department. And many years he was together with Emmanuel Wallerstein. Now, okay, since I mentioned Emmanuel Wallerstein, let me start from there. Now, if you remember last semester when we were talking about Emmanuel Wallerstein, I made a comparison between my work and his work. Now, I said that in 1960s, when I was a student in the Sociology Department of Middle East Technical University, I started doing research on capitalist development of capitalism in the villages, influenced by Vecel Kray's work. You know, I already talked about Vecel Kray's rural sociological work, and I mentioned also my own work. And then and I did research on Central Anatolia and Antalya villages. And then when I was writing the book, Underdeveloped Capitalism and Its Introduction, Its Penetration into Villages, I was influenced by Paul Baran and Svizi. Baran and Svizi. And I said that my actual work, Vecel Kray's work, my own work, and Baran's and Svizi's macro-sociological, political economic analysis of world capitalism, its development, and how in the third world countries, first world capitalism and third world capitalism, how they are different, they are similar. So I coined the concept of underdeveloped capitalism, or az gelişmiş kapitalizm in Turkish. Now, similarly, André Gunder Frank and Emmanuel Wallerstein started doing parallel, similar work. André Gunder Frank starting from Latin America, as you remember, Wallerstein starting from Africa and then moving into a more general framework of a theoretical framework where instead of focusing on nation states and societies, focusing on world economic system, world system, and hence capitalist, world capitalist economic system. Now, Çağlar Kejder further did also a similar work. I think I mentioned Çağlar Kejder when I was talking about Wallerstein. Now, Çağlar succeeded in publishing in English. In a minute, I will come to his book, State and Capital in Turkey, State and Class in Turkey, is one of his famous books, which I am sure you are exposed in your course on social structure of Turkey. Whereas I haven't written much in English, a few articles perhaps. I did, my publications are mostly in English. Anyway, after this introduction, let me go into further into Çağlar Kejder's sociological framework, sociological theoretical approach to the study of Ottoman Turkish modernization. Okay, now in this book, Class and State in Turkey, Çağlar Kejder starts really from the Byzantium times, because the land structure of Ottoman Empire and the Byzantium land structure, ownership of land and agricultural production, there are some continuities, he noted. As you know, in 1453, Istanbul is conquered by Fatih Sultan Mehmed, and Istanbul became the capital of Ottoman Empire. Previously, it was the capital of Eastern Rome. Eastern Rome. Anyway, but of course, that's just a starting point. His important chapter is the second chapter, actually, the process of peripheralization. Peripheralization. How, while in 16th century, Ottoman Empire was a dominant power in the Middle East. And it was in Istanbul or Baghdad or Sham or other cities in Middle East were so developed that cities in Europe, you know, they were underdeveloped regions. Now, how from that position of dominance and pre-capitalist world system, agricultural world system, in a sense, it became peripheralized, and it became semi-colony of Europe towards the end of 19th century. He goes into this, I think, this center-periphery relationships. Now, this is not just a periphery being incorporated into an expanding capitalist system, becoming a world capitalist system. It is transforming already existing world system into a periphery of the center of this new developing world system. Okay, I think it's very good. His third chapter is on Young Turk Restoration, how starting with 1939 Tanzimat and 18 of course 1839 and 1876 first constitutional monarchy and then second constitutional monarchy is now we discussed while we were discussing Ziya Gökalp or Prince Sabahattin, you know, it is their time. I will not go into that. But for me, the interesting chapter is looking for missing bourgeoisie and the following chapters. That chapter, the following chapter, state and capital, and the following chapter, populism and democracy, and the political economy of import substituting industrialization. Okay, now Çağlar analyzes these transformations, import substitution industrialization, up to 1980. Now here, of course, he's on the one hand, he's building his concepts in the framework of world capitalist system theory that together with Wallerstein and other theorists working in that perspective and Kader also. But also the peculiarity of Ottoman Turkish development. Now, I mentioned already the land structure, Ottoman land structure, where state owned the land and producers, the peasants, had just usufruct. That is, they had the right to use, to till the land, to produce on the land, and give a portion, tenth usher, tenth of the product to the representatives of the central state. There are already in each region, in each province, there are state representatives collecting taxes and raising soldiers. So when the states and center, the sultan and the people together, the viziers and grand vizier and the sultan decide for a war, from all these regions, soldiers go to that region. So the important thing is that here, between the state bureaucrats, okay, eventually during 19th century, these became bureaucrats because patrimonialism of Ottoman Empire is transformed into, in Weberian terms, into gradually rationalized bureaucratic system. And eventually, okay, this is Çağlar Kader's thesis, a state class emerged, a bureaucratic state class emerged, and in Ottoman times and continued in the Republican times, and prevented development of private ownership of land and extended private ownership of land or land large land ownership. Okay, large land ownership, like in Europe. In Europe, there are large land ownerships which are being eventually transformed into capitalist farms. Whereas in Turkey, there were state and its organization collecting taxes from peasants. Peasants are tilling small amounts of land with two oxen, or maybe they can double it. They might have four oxen, later two horses, whatever, that amount of land. You know? So it is, Çağlar Kaydar says, it eventually became petty commodity production in agriculture. Except in Eastern Anatolia and in some parts of Mediterranean and Aegean. Okay, here, maybe here I have to go into our work, our joint work together with Çağlar Kaydar. But before I go, let me finish this book and then let me go into that work. But here, I am referring here to this development of petty commodity production. That is, Turkish agricultural production eventually became commodity, I mean, farmers, peasants became small farmers producing commodity for the market. And in the cities, some industrialization started, and import substitution industrialization. So during, especially after, now up to 1950s, it was industrialization was state directed. It was a statist form of industrialization, 5-year plans, etc. Similar to Soviet planning experience. But I, from the middle of 1940s, especially during 50s. With the coming to power of Democratic Party, the small commodity producer farmers and craftsmen and traders in the cities voted for Democratic Party. So the statist Republican Party and marketist liberal, in quotation, liberal Democratic Party and a weak bourgeoisie, import substitution, industrialization. Now, during 60s and 70s, especially after the establishment of state planning office, etc., there was some more perhaps plan development, but the state class in Çağlar Kaydar's thesis, state class and this weak bourgeoisie continued their struggle, but under the dominance of state, but leading to conflicts of different fractions of bourgeoisie and emergence of political parties of nationalist, religious, socialist, all kinds, and during 1970s clashes, especially students clashing with each other. So actually here, Çağlar Kaydar uses two sociological concepts that you will remember from many other sociologists, social integration and system integration. Now, Giddens uses this, Bourdieu uses this concept, social integration. Is more people face-to-face interaction, integration through culture and language, system integration, more economic through market mechanisms on the one hand, and through power relationships. And now Habermas, this is Habermasian, and he gives reference actually. He uses these two concepts, and how there was crisis towards the end of 1970s, which led to 80 coup d'etat, coup d'etat. With that coup d'etat, the state class, bureaucratic class, or the domination of or claim of bureaucratic class to domination ended with the introduction of neoliberal policies. There is famous 24 January decisions, which opens Turkish economy to the global market. So unable, in a sense, to integrate at the national level, being in crisis, or because of the global forces like IMF and World Bank and others under their forcing, in a sense, the military regime gave in. Actually, before military regime, these decisions were taken, these liberalization decisions, and it is carried out with the force authority of military regime, and hence perhaps together with global capital, bourgeoisie became dominant over state class, over bureaucracy, but this time not alone again. But this time with global, let's say, joining the, with the global, and then maybe in an interview made with him. Here there is that interview done by Tuna Kuyucu, published in Development and Change. You can read that yourself. There he mentions that again, perhaps in recent decades, bourgeoisie or capital became not with state bureaucracy, perhaps with the party officials in each city or province or whatever. Anyway, this is a very scanty summarization of Çağlar Kaydar's framework of the Turkish import substitution industrialization before 1980, its crisis, and then the collapse of national development paradigm in the world and in Turkey, and it's being transformed into neoliberal privatization, all the processes started from especially after the collapse of Soviet Union, the global capitalist mechanisms became more and more dominant in many countries, including Turkey. Now he really tries to capture this development. This is a complex phenomena, and he captures it, I think, theoretically. Of course, there are deficiencies, there are points that can be criticized, whether the state class, you know, there are debates already about the beginning of the type of mode of production of during Ottoman Empire, during Republican era, etc., etc. But if you enter into this field, you will go more into detail of these studies. Now, let me go into a second work of Çağlar Kaydar. Now, this one is actually together with Zafer Yenal. agrarian change under globalization. Okay, we are just there. Huh? Eventually, from 1980 to 2011. Now, this research is done in 2011 in the villages in Antalya and İzmir, Dikili, Dikili, and two Serik, one in Antalya, the other Kumluca. Now, my own work is also in Serik and Manavgat. Anyway, now, in this article, this article is also present. You can read this. How under global transformation, how the national development policies of protecting small commodity producers in agriculture through price policy, through input of insecticides or other material necessary for agricultural production, or buying of the products to prevent price fluctuation, etc., etc. All these are gone from starting from 1980s, and the rest of the observation in this article is that throughout Turkey there were paths of rural transformation. Okay, this is our joint work, Çağlar Keder, Bahattin Akşit, and there were others, Nüket Sirman and Ayşe Saktanber and Arıkan, there were others. Now we tried to understand rural transformation in Turkey, agricultural transformation, or more rural transformation, transformation of the villages, because we accepted the villages villages as a unit. Now I qualify this in a sense as the field of Bourdieu, in the way that Bourdieu qualifies the field, how field has boundaries and the outside forces influence the actors in the field through the mechanisms of the field. So we thought that the villages are like fields, and market forces and state policies influence the villagers, the farmers, the peasants, through in terms of the type of village that they work, that they exist. Now, when we studied the many villages, and we came to the conclusion that there are four types of villages in Turkey. Now, one type of village are those Aegean and Mediterranean villages, coastal. These are southern and western Turkey coastal villages, where modern agricultural equipment is introduced, where capitalist relations of production are dominant, etc., etc. That is one type. The second type. Now, one variant of this is a large capitalist farm. The other one, small capitalists existing together. Whereas those large capitalist ones also disintegrated. Anyway, that is one. A second type of village was Central Anatolian cereal producing, wheat producing villages. They had something, tractors and 600 dönüms of land, dekars of land. Okay. Now here, these are rich farmers. Rich farmers. This is a second type. At of course, not richer than the coastal villages. Some villages as rich as the coastal ones. The third type is diversified village, more in the Black Sea, perhaps, and northern parts, western parts of internal central Anatolia, where there is migration, seasonal migration, as well as diversification of products. Not only agricultural production, but small-scale weaving or industrial production, or you know, that diversifying economic activities, you know, survival type of in order to survive. The village still, as a village, it survives. And then a fourth type of village, deserted village, especially in Central Anatolian northern part of Central, the villages, only old people are living. Sometimes the children of those who migrated to the cities, but send their children during summer, especially, to their parents in the village. So these four types of village, after globalization, now the 80s, this started, you know, we did this study during the end of 70s, the beginning of 80s, just the beginning of globalization, and agrarian change under globalization, and that is the zero point, starting point, four type of villages, three types, the Central Anatolian, northern Black Sea ones, migration, and many of them losing population through migration. Anyway, after 1985, rural population were less than urban population. So now this time, already 80%, more than 80% are living in the cities. So so many villages migrated into the cities. But now in this article, Kaydar and Yenal, Çağlar Kaydar and Zafer Yenal, when they studied these villages, they observed that now these villages are subject to casino type of, they use this, kumarhane, they use in Turkish, casino type of capitalism, because global capitalism, from the point of view of the farmers, is such an uncertainty of which agricultural product to produce, to shift from tomatoes to peppers or to whatever. So survival now under this global neoliberal economic policies or economic mechanisms, where the dominant actors are insecticide producers and distributors, or other agricultural goods, and the prices are globally decided. So instead of rural sociology or sociology of villages, now we have an agri-food agriculture, an agri-food production sector, a sector, an economic sector, and the villagers now are being transformed to be actors, to be agents. To what extent they can be agents, because their autonomy is so much reduced, because in one sense, before 1980, national state policies were protecting them, and the village type was also intervening between them. Now they are, farmers are face to face with global forces, global actors. Okay, I think I have to stop reviewing this article. I hope you will read it yourself. I didn't mention many other books, Çağlar Kayder, as you understand from his main, from my point of view, his main book, Class and State in Turkey. But for example, he has books on Istanbul, you know, as a global city, or how Istanbul is being a part of this new global economy, global system. Of course, he also focuses on urban poverty. Urban poverty. He has many research on these issues. Social policy for regional development in Eastern and Southeastern Anatolia. I didn't mention at all, together with Çağlar, we went to some large land-owning villages in Eastern and especially Southeastern Anatolia, and we studied their transformation as well, how that's a different type, actually. Okay, now, as I said, I think I have to stop here, and I have to go into gradually, slowly, into Nilüfer Göl'e. Okay, now, Nilüfer Göl'e, as I already said, is 1953 birth. Now she had her BA from Middle East Technical University Sociology. Her PhD is from France, EHES, École des Hautes Études and Sciences Sociales, okay, in 1982. She graduated in 1974 from METU. Okay, now she worked in Boğaziçi many years, but then she's working in France in this as École Hostess. Okay, but Etudes Social Sciences, Social Science Studies School. Okay. Now, as I already said, the contrast between, although they share many aspects of sociology of third world societies, sociology of Turkish modernization. Their focus is, while Çağlar Kayder focuses more on class and political economic development, socioeconomic development, Nilüfer Göl'e focuses, as I said, on more on culture. Okay, now her first study is on two professions, on architects and engineers. Architects and engineers as professionals, as professionally educated elites, or two components of professional elites in Turkey. A very successful book, actually, because she later used the material from this research in an article that I will go into. But before going into that article, I have to mention her work, her second work, actually, which made her famous. That is It is translated into English as forbidden modern, forbidden modern. In Turkish, it is published in 1991 as Modern Mahrem, Modern Mahrem. Now, this work, she carried out the research for this work in the second half of 1980s. Now, remember from Çağlar Keyder, import substitution industrialization went into crisis during the 70s, and then there was a coup d'etat, and then there was Özal government. There were an election where the military regime designed two parties, but a third party emerged, Özal's party, Anavatan party emerged, and carried out actually the neoliberal policies policies of actually the last government in 1980 before the coup d'etat, but with the force or with the power of military behind him, in a sense. So actually 80s, and then later after he died, Demirel became the president. Second half of 80s and 90s is a pluralistic democratic atmosphere in Turkey. Now, in this atmosphere, the political standpoints that emerged and proliferated, I will use this word, proliferated during 1970s, the nationalist, Islamist, socialist, communist, liberalist, statist ideologies. There is an ideological pluralism, and they are fighting with each other to capture, actually. Now, this is Nilüfer Gölen here. It says that now this competition in the political arena, in the political field, okay, let's think of it in Bourdieu's field dynamics of competition of actors. So there was a dominant Kemalist ideology during 30s, 40s, okay, 50s, it is being modified, 60s, it is being modified. In 70s, especially in the second half of 70s, it was in crisis. Now, alternatives that challenged started and started competing for the dominance of the field. Now, whose rules will be the norm of the national political field, and the field, other fields, cultural field, the subfields of the culture, or of the social fields, in the families, in the towns, in the villages. There was a widespread struggle in the second half of 70s. Now, the military regime stopped it through force. This is a state using repressive apparatuses. But now, with Özal, state repressive apparatuses became in the background. Now, ideological state apparatuses and a civil society, emergence of a civil society. Now, this emergence of civil society, especially, reached its Zenith after 1999 Marmara earthquake. Now, okay. Now, before that, we are again still in the second half of 1980s, where the Islamist group, Islamist movement, had students, female students entering, of course, there were all male and female students from the beginning in the universities. But during 80s, those who joined the Islamist movement started covering their heads. So a headscarf issue from 1983, 84 to the present. Now, in the present, you don't see it anymore, fortunately. That was a symbolic struggle, actually. It was symbolic of, or a representation of, if you like, the struggles at the other levels, at the other ideological, class, and religious, and ethnic competition struggle. Now, headscarf issue was one of the symbols of that struggle during 1980s. Now, at that very moment, Nilüfer Göle decided to study this issue by interviewing, a group interview, or interventionist sociological research, she calls them. She gathered with them, different groups, invited other people to speak, and discuss the issue. Now, what is the problem? Now, the woman students, she told, they said, you know, they are they believe that they have to cover their head, and they would like to attend classes, and they don't want to be prevented. So this is real headache, really, for those of us teaching. Now, from my point of view, I will not prevent anybody from entering into class because of dressing, you know. But the Higher Education Council says, no, you shouldn't allow, you should allow, really. But Nilüfer Güle did a good thing, and she studied and published this work, Forbidden Modern, Modern Mahrem. And there she studied how modernization in Turkey is, modernization and secularization, these two developments, how it is similar and how it is different from France or from Germany, from other countries. And now she came to the point that we shouldn't think of Western modernization as universal. Many others already were thinking along those lines, and Nilüfer Göle is one of the few in Turkey who taught along those lines. Alternative modernization or Turkish modernization, we have to think of Islam, whereas in, say, in Germany, after long struggles in France, religion in Germany and in France gave up dominating political arena and public sphere, and hence it become it became in the private sphere instead of public sphere. But Nilüfer Gül observed that now with this headscarf issue, no, the public sphere should be redefined. Whether Islam will be in the private sphere or public sphere, now that debate, and not only being in the private sphere or public sphere, really Nilüfer Göle expresses this very well in this article, secularism and Islamism in Turkey, the making of elites and counter-elites. Now this is a 1997 article, 6 years after publication of Forbidden Modern. Now in this article, she combines her study on engineers and architects, the professionals, and her study of women with headscarf. With that scarf, and she tried to decipher sociologically what are the demands of Islamist movement. Now, Islamist movement, and she makes this distinction. Now, Islamist movement is a political movement, whereas being Muslim is before modernity, people in Ottoman Empire in Turkey having the rituals of Islam, the rituals and behaving according to Islam is something, but demanding that life life world. Now here actually she uses Habermas's concept or phenomenologist concept of life world and system distinction. The life worlds of people, now what norms, what values should be dominant, not only in the public sphere, in the life world as well. Now during 90s, actually starting from 1970s, and during 80s, reaching to greater scope, and during 90s, now this is being discussed. And at the time this article is written, 1995, there was a government where Erbakan was the prime minister. The centralist party was the second the coalition. There was a coalition where the Islamist movement was in power, but unfortunately there was a military or postmodern intervention. So if it was left to its own dynamic, what would have happened sociologically? I sometimes wonder, maybe Nilüfer Göle also wonders. Anyway, in this article, or at the time it is written, I think that government, the Islamist liberal Doğruyol party and this Islamist party, Welfare Party, I think it was, yes, Refah Partisi, formed a coalition. Now, but the democratic conventions, democratic development, and the struggle of different parties and strata, it was really a crisis. A series of crises. Turkish alternative modernization goes through a series of crises. Now, before carrying out further from this path, let me mention that, as I already said, Nilüfer Göle combines his her research on engineers and architects and headscarf, and her general research into political movements, ideologies. And now how, for example, one of the interesting observations in her book, Forbidden Modern, how the Kemalist elite gave great importance to education of girls, women becoming freed from traditional controls. Now, you know, in the feminist sociology, it is being discussed, you know, whether whether it was a restricted liberation of women, or whether it was a starting point for further liberation. Okay, that's one. Now, these headscarf women in universities, actually, as a result of the success of Kemalist educational reforms, they entered into university. Kemalist reforms gave emphasis to education of all children, men, male and female, and hence all classes in the villages and in the towns, and equal access to education. And this was, I think, this is the success of Republican governments in Turkey, whether of the left or whether of the right. You know, when I was teaching the structure of social structure of Turkey, I observed that the percentage of women in the universities, women students, female students, surpassed around a few years ago, surpassed those of men. And there are more women in the universities than there are more female students in the universities than the male students. Now that is that's a success. You know, all governments, from the left or from the right, from the center, Islamist, secular, gave importance to education. But then, in democratic atmosphere, different lifestyles, different beliefs, different values will be in the field, in the political field, in the cultural field. Now, in scientific field, there's, you know, for all fields, in all fields, there are their criteria. In scientific field, also there's a struggle, but here the struggle is between different theories and approaches, and the decision is with data. Now, which data falsifies which theory? But in political fields, it is power. Now, in economic field, it is money, capital. Now, in the social field, okay, how many? Okay, now Bourdieu's different capitals. Anyway, now all these different capitals, and Nilüfer Güler mentions this in her article, how how they were struggling with each other during 90s, and then in, as you know, 2002, a new party that emerged from Welfare Party, and now left Erbakan, the engineer, you know, from engineering faculty, professor, engineering of Istanbul Technical University. He was leader up to that point of this Islamist movement. Now, after that, new leaders emerged, the present in the present of those leaders. As you know, Recep Tayyip Erdoğan is the president. Okay, now there is a video that I put here by Nilüfer Göle. I think you can listen to that. Now, in this video and in many other works that I didn't give reference, she actually talks about the struggle in European arena, Euro-Islam. Many of her studies is on Euro-Islam and how there's a struggle there. You know, there is Western democratic principles in the political how Islam as a religion and as a political movement emerges and what are its demands. So falling off the walls, after the disintegration of Soviet Union, the Berlin, giving reference to Berlin Wall, it's a good reading. Now, of this article, of her many other research and conceptualization in this alternative modernization, interpenetration of different cultures and different ideologies, different values. Instead of, although struggle is, people struggle for pure this ideology or that ideology, but it is not pure. It is interbreeding, interpenetration, hybridization. It is hybridization and alternative modernization goes together, or globalization and hybridization goes together. Okay, now as you know, I try not to summarize works of a sociologist, which will be unjust. If I claim that I summarized, then there are so many books and articles of both Kader and Göle here, but previously of Kray and Mardin, or of Gökalp and Sabahattin. You know, the attempt to summarize them is unjust for them. The point is to understand them and reading, finding an article or a book of that sociologist and reading it, understanding it, and not staying there, remaining there, but applying it into research, transferring it into research, gathering data on the basis of those articles and books that you read, and seeing whether these ideas have a correspondence with the reality. Anyway, with this, I will stop today's lecture. I hope you want to treat some articles by Kader or by Göle, Nilüfer Göle and Çağlar Kader. This is my presentation about them.